adopt the charter, the plan, now we're on the bylaws. The bylaws are your roadmap, okay? It tells you how many board seats you need to have. How many board seats do we have on this board? Okay. It also tells you how many board members you need to have a meeting. How many board members need to be present in order for the neighborhood council to conduct a meeting?
11.
11. What is that called?
Quorum.
The quorum, that's correct. How long do the officers serve?
2 years.
2 years. What committees have been created? All these things are in the bylaws. That's why it's key for you to be in your bylaws. Where are the regular board meetings? How do you join the committee? Who sets the agenda? Is it the president, or is it the executive committee, or is it the board? I deal with 15, 16 different neighborhood councils, and now it's 20, because I'm studying on But you, it depends on the neighborhood council and how you guys set up the bylaws or the standards. What are the rules of engagement? Hold the civility, right? What type of decorum are you, what's the bar, what are you held to? Can you vote, right? How many people took the ethics training? How many took the funding? Right? Okay, so if had you had something before you that was funding related, those who had taken the ethics and the funding, you would have been prohibited from voting. Okay, so it's important that you do it. There is no grace period currently for funding items, voting on funding items. You have to have taken the funding, which is available online to review, but it's going to give you a 20-minute overview of that. And then the ethics. The ethics is longer. It's about 2 to 3 hours online. And we will have in-person training coming up as well. Also, in your bylaws, some have provisions beyond just ethics and funding. Some have sexual harassment and other training that you have to take. And if you're not, then they may have a deadline, like 90 days out, 45 days out. If you do not take it within there, then they can prohibit you from voting if it's stated in your bylaws. So standing rules. Does the neighborhood council have standing rules? Okay, so standing rules are important because the bylaws are like the constitution, but the, you know, so let's say, you know, you can't, the constitution says, you know, government can levy taxes, but then you see the tax bill is like this big. That's the standing rules. The standing rules basically help you lay out what the processes and the procedures are for, you know, committee. Let's say, oh, the president sets the agenda, or the executive committee sets the agenda. How do they set the agenda? How do you get items from committees, other committees, up to the executive committee? Or how do you, as a board member, get items that you want to be heard to the executive committee to be heard? Those things are laid out in the standing rules. There are also things that are laid out in the standing rules that representation of the neighborhood council. You can't just go to city council and say, hey, my name is Marlene, and I'm here from the LA 32 neighborhood council, and I oppose XYZ ordinance in front of council if the board has not taken that position. But those type of spokesperson rules and procedures are laid out in your standing rules. I would say the good rule of thumb is when you find yourself not being clear on something that's in your bylaws, that's a good place to look at creating a standing rule around it. The Brown Act. All right, that's the biggie, right? So the Brown Act is clear. So we're open. The Brown Act is an open meetings law. Everything has to be done open, in an open forum and transparent. So let's say you have a meeting like today. How far is this a regular meeting or special?
Regular general
board meeting. So how long in advance do you have to post an agenda for a regular meeting? 72 hours. And what's another other times of a special meeting has 24 hours. So for the most part, you want to make sure that you're using the right terminology for the meetings that you're holding. Regular meetings is where you get the bulk of the work done. Special meetings, I would say, use those very diligently, because if you call too many meetings, your board members may not, they have, you know, everyone has lives, and maybe, you know, many people that serve on different councils and other boards have other responsibilities. So if you keep calling special meetings, you might not get enough for a quorum, and you might just waste those people's time. So just be diligent about crafting your agenda and calling your regular meetings, which is why schedules are important. We talked about this, so we have a quorum of 11, we have 21 board members, so 11 members in, 11 members constitute a meeting. So, also, some other parameters about your meeting that they need to be accessible, meaning Americans with Disability Act, they have to be ADA compliant. So when you're setting up your aisles and your entryways and your access to buildings and things of that nature, you need to make sure that the bathroom is sufficient, the aisle is sufficient, that people have an opportunity to come if they come by transit, if you dropped off, or if it's, you know, if it's local transit, public transit, accessible, things of those nature. Also, some of the most intrusive, like we have one today, we have the captioners here. That's an accommodation that is provided by the Department of Disability at no cost to neighborhood council when it's requested. With that, you have to put on every agenda, whether it's committee, board member, board agenda, regular or special, the provision to whom they can contact on the board so that they can request those accommodations. Large print is also an accommodation that can request, can be requested. If there's someone that you know, needs a larger print, they contact you. We do require a 72-hour notice. However, if you constantly know that this stakeholder comes every single time, you should provide it. Also, translation and a variety of languages as well. It's not required under the ADA, but it is an accommodation that should be provided should someone request it. Okay. A couple of other things, new provisions under the Brown Act is one, on your agenda, you have to have required language that say tonight, we emailed everyone out this package, and the stakeholders should have an opportunity to see anything that the board member gets, provided that a majority of the board members receive it. So if you have a website, go to the website. You have an office, have a binder. Tonight we brought a binder and we put it. It's in the back. And so we provided a copy, a reference copy. This will be for whomever becomes the treasurer. The president, a copy of all the materials that we have today. So just in case we ran out, we don't have enough copies for the entire stakeholders that are in attendance. There's a reference copy that they can review so they know what the board is seeing as well. So you have to provide that for your neighborhood council. Also, just of late, a couple of months ago, a new broadband provision came out stating that when you take an action, you must call the vote of the action, yays, nays, abstentions, if it passed or didn't. You have to say it out loud so that people know who voted. If it passed or it didn't. Also, the board count, the board vote count form, which Ben's going to tell you about a little later, will probably assist you with that as well. Serial meeting. Does anyone know what a serial meeting is?
I'll let somebody else.
Anybody? A serial meeting then the next person sends to the next person, but one by one by one by one, till they get to that six people, then you have enough to swing a vote, right? So the rule of thumb is, don't talk outside the meeting. If it's information only, then it's information only. There's no discussion. There's send it to directly to the person who's making the agenda, or directly to the executive committee, or speak at the committee agenda, at the committee meeting, the executive committee meeting, so that you're not having discussion outside of an open forum. Because anything that's on the agenda, anything that's coming before you, you should not, a majority of the board should not be speaking on it outside of the general board meeting. Okay, so just be careful, because it's easy to do a secret meeting, because no, nothing's a secret unless you don't say it, right? You can, oh, don't tell anybody that. Oh, you know what? And then the next person. So that's how things, you know, unintentionally, right? But ultimately, you want to make sure that you're doing the service that you are here to do, and hold your meetings open and transparent. So that's the rights of the public, of course. Rights of the public. We have public comment earlier. You should always take public comment before you make a decision. Not only do you have to have an item that's public comment on the agenda, but on every item on the agenda, anyone from the stakeholders can comment on any item that's listed on the agenda. So when you're before you're going to enter into discussion, say we're going on like item number six, XYZ planning decision. You will call for public comment. So call for public comment. Anyone wants to come up and speak on public comment, yay or nay, let them go. Then the board carries on its discussion and takes their vote. Because why do you want to take public comment first? Right? Because if you take the decision and then you call public comment, what does it matter, right? They're like, oh, what does it mean to say my piece on the matter? So they don't have to sign in. Sign-in sheets are optional. They, even on the speaker card, they don't really have to use a name. They can say John Doe. They don't have to sign it. It's not a requirement. And of course, they have the right to video and audio tape. One note on that, just make sure you have a space so that a designated space so that everyone is basically held to the same rule of thumb. Ethic? Yes.
Question. Do they have to have a speaker card presented before the action item?
That's going to come up in standing rule, right? So, see, you're in mid-discussion. Say someone, you already called for public comment. Really, it's going to look for the presiding officer. It's a balance of strictness and community, right? So rules and community. So you don't want it so stringent that it's like, okay, no, we cut it off. But and sometimes you will have to do that. Say, for at our Board of Neighborhood Commissioners, when we have certification hearings, we can have 300 people waiting to have public comment. But the chair has the right to limit public comment to 45 minutes, yay, 45 minutes, or whatever the time frame they want to do. And so if you're in the middle of something and someone has a burning desire, it may impact the way you vote. So it's going to really be up to the chair, the presiding officer, and the board to create those standing rules that allow for some of this interaction that won't disrupt the neighborhood council from doing their business, but also allow for adequate community participation. So it's something that you all are going to have to decide. Yes, sir.
You always announce ahead of time, and you do whatever it is that's on the agenda. The recording secretary or the other secretary will announce it to the stakeholders once or twice to make sure that everybody had an opportunity to fill that card.
Right. Yes. Okay. Ethics and conflict of interest. So that's ethics. Everyone has to take the ethics. It's good for 2 years. Every 2 years you have to renew it. If you do not take the ethics and the funding training, you are not allowed to vote on matters that are funding. So conflict of interest. Basically, it's my one-liner. Don't guess, call the city attorney. You guys are all board members, and you all have the right to call the city attorney that's assigned to your division, I mean, to and there's a template response that the city attorney will give you, as well as they need to review the items that are being requested to see if they're subject to the Public Records Act. And even if the items are subject to the Public Records Act, all, maybe not all information contained in those items are subject to the PR, to the Public Records Act, like addresses and things of that nature. So it is imperative that you contact the city of the city attorney and your and said who's your neighborhood environment advocate to alert them of that so that they can guide you with how to respond. Also, say someone requests documents that don't exist, then you're not obligated to create documents to fulfill the public records request. But again, you have to check with the city attorney, and they will guide you and let you know how to fulfill the request. Okay, you are able to charge a $1 processing fee, and then if you have to get a hard copy, it's 10 cents a page. Okay, but again, check in with the city attorney so that we can make sure that it's done in a matter of time because they can put a lawsuit against the city. And it doesn't necessarily have to be from your stakeholder; it can be anyone across the city. We had some people PRing the entire neighborhood council system, all 95, from another a place in the valley, and they were just asking for this information. So we had to make sure everyone responded because the city would then be liable. Okay, Americans with Disabilities Act. Again, we talked about this a little bit. A reasonable accommodation. I'll just give you the definition for what a reasonable accommodation is. Briefly stated, a reasonable accommodation may be thought of as efforts made to remove barriers which prevent or limit participation by persons with disability in a program, service, or activity. The following things to consider when selecting a meeting location or an event. So it's not just your committee meetings or your general board meetings, but it's also your event. Okay, so keep that in mind. There is a reasonable accommodation liaison with the Department of Disability, and they will come out. And in your packet, the board member handbook, there's a whole guide about the Americans with Disability Act and how to really make sure that your events and things of that nature are appropriate. But there is someone in the Department of Disability that can come out and check a site for you, or if you call them, they'll give you guidance as to what you need to conform to so that your event is appropriate. So common types of what we talked about, large print, captioning, like we have tonight, sign language interpreters, those are free of charge as well. And so in your packet, there is the number for the Department of Disability so that you can call and reach out to them. Just one thing, if you don't understand, if you need information, call the department. The department is going to help you out. Don't feel shy about, this is a lot of information for you all to absorb in one night. You will absorb it over time as you put it into practice, but use us as a resource. We have a helpline that works every day from 9 to 5. One of the field staffers are always on it to provide you the information that you need. So if you don't understand it, call us up. If you want to reach out to the department and you're not getting an answer, call us up. We will help you move things forward. All right, successful neighborhood council meetings. So what makes a neighborhood council meeting? Before, during, and after. So before a meeting, what are some of the things that you have to do before the meeting? Yep, make an agenda. What else? Post the agenda, that's right. that's an item on your agenda. But what about the grid? What is GRYD? I don't know what that is, right? So be careful of the issue. You know, Brown Act tells you to, you know, use like a 20-word description. So if it says grid, I'm like, ah, but if it says, oh, extension of summer night flight from the game reduction youth development, and I'm like, oh, game reduction youth development, you know about that? I'm going to go. Maybe I want to support it, maybe I don't. But if you have to be descriptive enough on your agenda so that people, the stakeholdership, are able to make a determination whether they want to come and provide input or not, right? So especially when it comes down to, like, anything with money, you should have the vendor, the dollar amount, and the purpose. That's just a baseline. Planning projects, address location, what they're requesting, things of that nature. And if it's coming from a committee, you can also include a draft motion on there if it's coming up from the committee, if they're recommending it or not. Of course, you always have to have public comments. Some people have it at the beginning, some people have it at the end, some people have it twice at the beginning and at the end. It's really gonna be up to the board. Of course, you need to have the required agenda language, the ADA language, the public access records. During the meeting, this is pretty important. Communicate clearly. Someone has to chair the meeting, right? That's simply the president. And when you talk about the standing rules, which I hope you guys will do, it'll talk about, you know, board member as well as stakeholder. How often do you get to speak? How long do you get to speak? You know, what are the rules? Make sure that at the beginning we have a script that's also in the board member handbook that lays out the rules for the community so everyone knows what rules they're playing by. You know, so if you can say, well, here's the code of civility. You said we're going to abide by the code of civility. You said we're only giving 2 minutes. It's listing, you know, everything that's outlined. So if they know up front, then there's less chance. And if something gets out of line, you always have something in writing to point back to. And it's not my opinion or, oh, you know, I'm treating you unfairly. No, this is what we outline. Remain impartial. Enforce fairness, right? Stay on course. Don't let the board members go off on a tangent, you know, because that would kill the functionality of the board because you allow one person to just go on